Hello everyone, welcome back. Ocean here. So this is the second part of the idioms from mythology video we were doing. I've already done the first part, so if you have not watched it, watch it and come back to this part again. So this is the second part. Needless to say, these idioms are very important, so pay good attention and let's begin with it. So first one for this part is Achilles's heel. Now it is a person's weak spot. So Achilles's heel is a person's weak spot. All right. So the myth is Achilles was a Greek hero. He was a Greek hero whose mother was Tethys. Tethys was basically a sea goddess. So when Achilles took birth, it was professed that he would die young, that he would die at a young age. So what his mother did was she was a sea goddess, right? So she dipped him into a river called Styx, S-T-Y-X, Styx, which would render him invincible and immortal. Alright, so Tethys did this. She dipped her newborn child into a river called Styx so that he would be invincible and immortal. No one would be able to defeat him or conquer over him, and he would not die. He would be immortal. Alright, so however, what happened was she held him by the heel. Alright, so she held her kid by his heel, and she dipped him into the river. But what happened is the heel was not dipped in the water, so it left a vulnerable area. And later on, Achilles died. Achilles would later die as prophesied by an arrow to his heel. So I have attached the photo here. It would be more clear now. So this is Tethys, I believe, and this is Achilles, right? So she is dipping him into this river, alright. So now she held him by his heel. But what happened was the heel was not dipped as a result of this. So this heel was Achilles' weak point. And later on, okay, so he was dipped into the river and his whole body was now immortal and invincible. But his heel was left vulnerable. His heel was left weak. So later on, how he died was he died by an arrow that hit his heel, alright. So that is Achilles' heel. Achilles' heel is basically a person's weak spot. Not exactly physically, it can be, even mental or even in terms of relations with others. So for example, maybe a person's weak point is his parents, right? I mean, when it comes to his parents, he can do anything. He can be made to do anything, right? So that would be a person's weak spot, right? So this was Achilles' heel. Next we have the apple of discord. Apple of discord is a cause or a dispute or an argument or a rivalry, something to contend about, right? Something which causes contention all around. That is apple of discord. So again, something related to Achilles here. So during the marriage of sea goddess Tethys, Tethys was his mom, and Peleus, his dad, Achilles' dad and mom, when they were getting married, all the gods and goddesses were invited except for Eris. Alright, Eris. Eris was the goddess of strife and discord. So everyone was invited except for Eris. I don't know why, but she was not invited. So she got offended, obviously, for being left out. So in a fit of anger, she crashed the wedding and threw a golden apple with an inscription for the most beautiful. So what she did is she crashed the wedding and basically threw a golden apple which had an inscription on it saying for the most beautiful. So basically this golden apple was for the most beautiful one. So every goddess in that ceremony, in that marriage, felt that she was entitled to the golden apple, and there was a large dispute among them as to who should get the apple. So that's how she created dispute and argument and rivalry and contention in the marriage. That what Ares did by throwing the apple off discord in, right? So that is apple of discord. All right, so this is what's happening here. These women are fighting and all for the golden apple, right? Next we have siren voices, siren songs or siren calls. What this basically means is the temptation or appeal of something that seems very attractive but is also dangerous, and if yielded to would have bad results, right? So something which looks very attractive but is dangerous, right? And if you yield to that temptation, it would be very bad for you. It would have bad results for you. So that is siren voices or siren song or siren calls. Now, the myth is sirens, so not the siren which is on a ambulance, that siren, we are not talking about that siren. Here, siren in the mythology, siren or entanglers were mystical monsters who were either half woman, half bird, or half woman and half fish, who would tempt unwary seamen by singing sweet songs. So they would sing sweet songs, and this would tempt unwary, unaware seamen who would sail towards them and perish on rocks or dangerous waters, or forget everything and eventually die of hunger. So when they heard this song, heard the song of sirens, they would go towards them, and many times they would perish on rocks or dangerous waters. Call it, their ships would perish. Or what happened? The other thing that happened was when they used to hear these songs, they used to forget everything, and then they eventually died of hunger. So that's what these mystical monsters did through their songs or voices or calls, right? So, thus the idiom, siren voices, siren song, or siren call, right? So these were basically sirens, half woman, half bird, or half woman, or half fish, and they used to sing beautiful songs to allure seamen, and who would eventually die when they used to get allured or get tempted, and the result would be bad, right? Next, we have lotus eaters. Right, lotus eaters basically refer to lazy, dreamy people who are only concerned with their own pleasures and comforts, and they are not concerned about anything else. So, lazy dreamer people, dreamy people are lotus eaters. So, myth is in Homer's Odyssey, there is a mention of the lotophagy people, right? So, these people used to eat the fruit of lotus tree. There was this some tree, I don't know. So, the fruit of lotus tree they used to eat, and they would forget about their families, their friends, and would lose all desire to return to their homes, and would only wish to live in the inactive, dreamy state after eating that fruit. So, this is the myth around it. Lotus eater basically refers to lazy, dreamy people who are not concerned with anything else, right? So this was it, right? Let's move on. Stygian gloom, Stygian, Stygian gloom. It means dark, murky, melancholy, gloom, or right. So when you are in a dark, murky, melancholy, gloomy state, that would be Stygian gloomy, Stygian gloom. All right. So again, there is a mention of this river Styx. We have discussed it, right? So the word Stygian comes from the river Styx, which is name of the principal river in the kingdom of Hades, right? The underworld, where the underworld of death in the Greek mythology is the kingdom of Hades. So there was this river which used to flow in that kingdom. This was the river over which Charon, the boatman, was said to ferry the spirits of death, right? So it was the kingdom of dead, right? So people after dying used to come here, either to the good land, the Hadesian fields, or either to the bad lands, right? Or to the hells, so as to say. So there was this river in which Charon, a boatman named Charon, used to ferry the spirits of death. The Greeks and the Romans would place a coin in the hand or the mouth of the deceased, so to serve as a fare, right? And from there, the meaning broadened to describe things which are dark, dreary, and menacing, right? So if it's not too much, I'll just explain it again. When someone used to die in the ancient Greece or Rome, what they did is they would place a coin in the mouth of their in the mouth or the hands of their dead ones, because they used to believe that when they will die, when they will be spirits, they will use this money to pay to Charon the boatman, who would ferry them across the river Styx, which used to flow in the Hades kingdom. So and through that they would reach to their final goal, final destination, hell or heaven, right? So that was the Greek mythology, and that is the Stygian gloom, referring to things which are dark, dreary, and menacing. All right. So he was Charon over here. You can see him. All right. Let's move on. All roads lead to Rome. It basically means that a said outcome can be reached by many methods. There are many methods to reach a conclusion or an outcome or an idea. Right. This phrase basically refers to road system of Roman Empire, where Rome was positioned in the center, and every road was attached to it. So you take any road and you keep traveling on that, and you take any road and you will end up at Rome, right? So that's what this means. All roads lead to Rome, right? The meaning is the same outcome can be reached by many methods or ideas. Now, next one is an interesting one. The writing is on the wall. It means a premonition or a portent or a clear indication that something is going to happen. A failure or a disaster is going to come. It's a clear premonition or a clear indication of that something will happen in the future which would be very bad or disastrous for someone or something, right? So that is that's what this idiom means. The writing is on the wall, right? The myth is this phrase comes from the biblical story of Daniel, in which a prophet interprets some mysterious writing that a disembodied hand had inscribed on the palace wall, telling King Belshazzar that he would be overthrown, right? So this was a small myth. So this embodied hand wrote something on the wall, and a prophet did what? He interpreted it, that mysterious writing, and he told King Belshazzar that he would be overthrown. So that is what this idiom means. The writing is on the wall. All right. Next, we have to rise like a phoenix, Harry Potter, right? You know what phoenix is, right? Harry Potter's. I'm sorry. Meaning is to reach on the top, peak or eminence, or to be immortal. Or it also means to be to become successful again after seeming to have failed completely. Now, phoenix was a bird. Phoenix was a long-lived bird that would cyclically regenerate itself or otherwise take birth again after burning in a show of flames and combustion, and then again he would rise from its predecessor's ashes. Now, people who have watched Harry Potter know what I'm talking about. You know the Dumbledore's bird phoenix, right? So basically this bird was a long-lived bird, and when it used to die, it would just burn off in a bright show of flames and combustion, and after a while the ashes which remain, a new baby bird would rise from those ashes. So that was phoenix. It symbolically means to become successful again after seeming to have failed completely. When it seems like you have failed completely, but you still become successful again, you still rise again from that failure, that would be to rise like a phoenix. All right. Now, next we have to clean the organs, stables, right? So it basically means to clean up a condition or a place marked by great accumulation of filth or corruption. So when you clean up a condition or a situation where there is great filth or great corruption, right, that would be to clean the Augean stables, right? So the myth is Augeas, the mythical king of Elis, kept great stables. The stable, you know what stable is, right? So he used to keep great stables that held 3000 oxen, right? And he had not cleaned them for 30 years, until Hercules was assigned the job. So he assigned the job to Hercules to clean the stable which held 3000 oxen, and it had not been cleared for 30 years. So it had great accumulations of filth and all. So what Hercules did was, he was Hercules, so he would do something epic, right? So Hercules did clean the stables by causing two rivers to run through the stables. He somehow got two rivers to run from the stables, and the rivers cleaned everything up. I don't know. Anyway, so this is Hercules here, and this is the stable as it seems, and these rivers are flowing through the stable, cleaning everything up. Alright. So basically meaning cleaning the Augean stable basically means to clean up a condition or a place marked by great accumulation of filth or corruption. Right. Now again, there's a mention of Cerberus. So the idiom is a soap to Cerberus. It means to make an offer or a bribe to someone who may cause trouble or act as an obstacle in some work. So, as I told you, Cerberus was a three-headed dog who used to guard the gates of hell. He would not let anyone enter or not anyone go out from the hells. He would guard those gates. But there were three heroes who wished to visit hell and come back. So obviously Cerberus would be an obstacle to them. He would not let them pass, and even if they passed, he would not let them come out. So what they did is they gave him a SOP, which basically is a honey cake with sedatives in it. So he gave sop to Cerberus, and Cerberus slept, right, due to it, and they visited hell and came back out. So a sop to Cerberus basically means to make a bribe or an offer to someone who may cause trouble or prove as an obstacle in some work. All right, so that is a sop to Cerberus. Here you can see. All right, next up we have sword of Democles. So basically it's a sword hanging over the head, a sense of insecurity and a danger, impending doom or a disaster. So some sense of insecurity and danger that you have, that a disaster is about to come or a failure or a bad thing is about to happen, that would be sword of Democles. Now myth is, there was a king named Dionysius. He was very powerful and extremely happy, and his iron-fisted rule had made him many enemies. So he was always tormented by the fear of assassination, that someone would surely come and kill him. So he always kept himself safe and took precautions and all. And even though he had great power and great wealth, he was not happy. He was very unhappy because he had to live in fear all the time. He had to take all these precautions and all. So he was very unhappy. And one day he was sitting in his court, and a court flatterer named Democles came, and he showered him with compliments and all. And he remarked that how blissful this king's life must be. He said, your life would be very good. You have so much power. You have so much wealth. You have everything you need. So this king, he got irritated by him, and he said that, okay, if you like my life so much, why don't you taste it yourself and make a trial of my good fortune. So he said, okay, I have a good fortune. I have great wealth and great power. Why don't you have a taste of it for a day or so? So the guy Democles accepted. He was like, okay, I accept. So what he did was, the king seated him, that is Democles, on a golden couch and ordered a host of servants for him. Now he was treated with succulent cuts of meat and lavished with scented perfumes and ointments. And Democles could not believe his luck. He was like, okay, everything is going so great. I have immense wealth now. I have immense power. I have all the good food, good drinks, good servants, everything. But just as he was started to enjoy his life of a king, he noticed that Dionysius had also hung a razor sharp sword. All right. So the original king had hung a razor sharp sword from the ceiling, and it was positioned just over Democles' head, suspended by a single thread of horsehair. So now it can fall anytime, and it was right above Democles' head. So now Democles would always live in a fear that this sword will fall anytime and he would die. And due to this, it was impossible for him to savor the opulence of the feasts or enjoy the servants or enjoy the wealth or enjoy anything at all. So at last he gave up. At last he said sorry, and he excused himself by saying that he no longer wished to be so fortunate, and he understood the king, the Dionysius's problem, right? So this was a myth around sword of Democles, right? So here is what happened. This is Democles. These are the servants and all. This one is the king, the original king, and this is a sword being suspended right over his head, suspended by a horsehair, an extremely thin horsehair, which would fall anytime, and due to this he could not enjoy something, right? So symbolically it means a sense of insecurity or danger, right? So let's say you have a job, you got a very nice job with good packages and all the perks and all, but at the same time there is a possibility that you can be fired anytime. There is nothing that stops the employer from firing you, and you can be fired anytime without any reason, without giving you any reason. So that would be a sort of Democles. You would always have a sense of insecurity that, okay, now I might get fired, and so you'll not be able to really enjoy the wealth or the benefits that the job is giving you, and that would be sort of Democles. All right, let's move on. The burden of Sisyphus, it basically means a toilsome or an unattainable goal or a work, right? A toilsome and unattainable goal or work is the sword, is the burden of Sisyphus. Now Sisyphus was a great Greek king. He was punished by the gods to carry a big stone to the top of the mountain, but as soon as he reached on the peak, the stone would roll down the slope and he would again go down and carry it to the top, and again it would roll down. So that's what happened. He kept on doing this work. This was his burden, a toilsome and an unattainable goal. He could never keep that stone on the peak of the mountain because it would again and again roll down. So hence his burden, his work was toilsome and unattainable. All right. So this is him pushing the rock rock all the way up to the peak, and again this rock would fall off, this rock would roll off from the other side, and again he would carry it. So that's what he did, Sisyphus. All right. Next is sowing the dragon's teeth. It means doing something that may lead to disaster or even war in the future. So that is sowing the dragon's teeth. All right. So the myth is Greek hero Cadmus once went to fetch water from a nearby spring, but the spring belonged to a dragon. All right. And this dragon was the offspring of a god called Ares. Ares was the god of savagery and war. And this dragon said no, I will not let you take water from this spring. But Cadmus required it urgently for a ritual. So what he did was he killed the dragon and took the water. All right. So now Ares was the guardian or the father of this dragon, was angry at it. And he played a trick on this Greek hero Cadmus. He said, okay, now you have killed my dragon. Take the dragon's teeth now and sow them into the soil, and due to this you will become mighty in the war. So Cadmus did so, but when he sowed the dragon's teeth, what happened was a great crop of warriors was produced, who were the son of the teeth of the dragon and offspring of Ares, and they were bristling with swords and spears, full of warrior spirits, ready to kill Cadmus. So this is what happened when he sowed the dragon's teeth. He thought it would be good for his future, but what happened is a great crop of warriors rose from those teeth and they were determined to kill him. Right? So that is sowing the dragon's teeth, doing something that may lead to disaster or even to war in the future. Alright? So these were the warriors, the fighters that rose from the dragon's teeth. Next we have Pyrrhic victory. Pyrrhic victory is a victory won at an excessive cost. So the story is Pyrrhus, a Greek general, was the king of Epirus. He was the strongest opponent of early Rome. He fought many battles, and although all of them were victorious, he was victorious in all the battles. They caused him heavy losses in terms of death of his best officers, wealth, troops, and thus the term Pyrrhic victory was coined. Basically, it means a victory which is won at an excessive cost. You pay more than what you win. So that would be a Pyrrhic victory. All right. That is a Pyrrhic victory. Right. So this is the end. This is the end of the second video as well. I have already made the first video. Go ahead, watch it. This was the second video. I hope you learned something. I hope it was interesting to you. I hope it was a sort of break from your hectic preparation schedules. I know you are studying a lot now. So good luck. Good luck with your studies. And I'll see you again in the next video. If you like this content, make sure you subscribe, like, and share this video with everyone. Put it down in the comment section below what you felt about this video. If you had any suggestions, or maybe you have some video requests, some specific things that you want me to do, I'd do them. So just put them all down in the comment section below. And thank you so much. I'll see you in the next video. Bye.